Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this lecture I want to talk to you about the concept of paradigm shifts. First, what is a paradigm? The word paradigm traces its origin from Greek paradigma, which means pattern, a set of rules. In modern philosophy and science, and in the social sciences, in the humanities, it's used in the sense of a framework of concepts and procedures, a model of reality which allows us to operate within it. The word was popularized and introduced into the philosophical and scientific and humanistic social lexicon by philosopher of science Thomas Kuhn, who published a tremendously influential book in 1962 called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, in which he argued very strongly and successfully against the then prevalent theory that science progresses through a cumulative process of the addition of knowledge and addition of new discoveries of how reality actually operates, and this process, presumably that was the received wisdom, which by the way is the received wisdom to this day, despite Kuhn's brilliant effort. So the wisdom was that science and human knowledge as such progresses through this cumulative slow process of addition and new discoveries. So Kuhn actually argued in this book that quite the contrary, science operates in sudden, dramatic, revolutionary jumps, which involve the complete abandonment of previously established truths, the previously established models of reality, which he called paradigms, and the adoption of new ones. And this process is really fascinating. And totally deservedly has been copied, as it were, outside of the narrow field of philosophy of science to pretty much the entirety of human knowledge when it comes to the role of paradigms in how we think about reality. So in this lecture, I'll be unpacking this a little bit further. Kuhn describes paradigms as recognized scientific achievements that for a time provide model problems and solutions. Now, this is a really important concept that I want to unpack a little bit here. This is a time-bound model of reality, right? So inevitably, it will, as it were, expire. It will be abolished and substituted with a new model. This is his argument in the book. And while the model is still valid, as it were, it provides a set of problems. It defines reality as a set of problems and a set of possible verifiable solutions, right? And this is something that is quite specific to the sciences and to the field of philosophy of science, but it gives us an insight into the role of paradigms as described by Kuhn, because the paradigm is a concept, and this is a working definition that I will be using for the remainder of this lecture, provides a complete framework of concepts and procedures for operating within a reality. And by that I mean a framework which allows us to map what is and what is not, allows us to think of reality in a certain way, act in that reality in a certain way. It gives us a set of procedures for evaluation of the appropriateness of certain actions and inappropriateness of other sets of actions, of success and failure. It gives us a road for operation within that reality. So this is a profound, as it were, framework over the way we think about the world and ourselves in that world. And I'll unpack this a little bit further. More importantly, a paradigm, and we always operate within a paradigm, so there's no exception here. A paradigm defines the rules and when it comes to living in a place and time, and gives us a way of measuring the validity of when it comes to science of what has been discovered or the results of experiments, and when it comes to life in general in any specific field, it allows us to measure the validity of statements about phenomena. That's the role of the paradigm, in effect. Okay, so I will continue this lecture using the model that Kuhn himself proposed as the model of the life and death, as it were, of a paradigm. And this model, depending on how you represent it, has a varying number of parts, but they can be boiled down to these four parts. So each paradigm starts as a normal set of observation. It is the normal, in fact. So it is perceived by the people operating within it as normality itself. So its statements are perceived as the commonsensical perspective on reality, and its dogmas are basically the foundational truths of that reality. So this is the normal. And this stage is followed by a crisis of that paradigm, and we'll talk more about this in a while. The crisis then is followed by a shift to a new paradigm. And then that new paradigm is stabilized and normalized into the new normal. And then the cycle continues. So I, for the remainder of this lecture, will go through each of these stages. So we start with the normal. This is the stage in which we have normal operation of a paradigm's rules and procedures. And we have a dominant paradigm which provides the foundational basis for looking at reality and operating within it. So you could say, you could observe your specific reality, or you could observe, let's say, specific conditions in a given field, or in science in general, in physics, for example, and try and determine whether this field is operating within its own dominant paradigm. And Kuhn describes the stage in a very interesting set of observations. One of the most interesting, from my perspective, is this notion that when operating within the parameters of a dominant paradigm in its normal stage of operations, there is no aiming at the discovery of novelties. The way he frames it, normal science does not aim at novelties of fact or theory, and when successful, finds no novelties of fact or theory, right? So it's a self-enclosed system. It is internally coherent, and what I mean by that is that from within the paradigm, everything makes sense. The world makes perfect sense. There are no issues with the world. Everything is perfect, as it were. There might be some problems, there might be some things to fix, but there doesn't seem to be anything new to discover, or there doesn't seem to be anything fundamental that needs changing. Right? Everything seems to work. It's internally coherent. And this stage is really interesting when you think about it from the perspective not of science as such, but from the perspective of human learning, because the reaction to reality when it comes to learning is really instructive about the stage we find ourselves in. So entrepreneur and thinker Jordan Hall has a fascinating post on Medium on thinking and simulating thinking, in which he unpacks this very interestingly. So I'll read these few passages. And he starts by talking about early learning. If you remember learning how to drive a car or ride a bike, you likely recall transitioning from the certain, unsure, exploratory moments of early learning to the increasingly effortless, unconscious process that now allows you to drive from work to home without even noticing that you did so. In the first case, learning, we are in a costly, awkward, and error-prone explore mode. This mode is really rather terrible at getting things done. But when you find yourself in a novel environment or in need of innovating new tools or techniques, Explore Mode is precisely the right place to be. So we have the situation where something is new and radically challenging, and you're in a stage of Explore Mode where everything is uncertain and you have to figure out the rules, right? And that's Explore Mode, the way he frames it. But once you've mapped the territory and have identified the things to look out for and the appropriate responses to those things, it's time to move to Habit Mode. And this is where it gets interesting, because habit is really rather terrible at exploring reality, creativity and innovation, but it's fast and allows for efficient optimization. And what Jordan Hall terms as Habit Mode is perfect to describing the dominant paradigm in its normal stage of operations. Because the normal stage of operations of a dominant paradigm is exactly characterized by habitual thinking, deductive top-down thinking, which operates always already from a given dogma, from general procedures, from rituals which are already established, from rule sets that you haven't had to develop, you've been enculturated into, right? So you find yourself enculturated into a set of procedures, rituals, rule sets, traditions, and you're acting habitually within them. This is a sign that you're operating in a normal stage of a dominant paradigm. You never really think inductively bottom-up in this kind of situation. You're always deductively following general rule sets. And what Kuhn says here is really interesting, because he describes this stage as a stage where you see what the paradigm frames you to see, in effect. This depends both upon what he looks at and also upon what his previous visual conceptual experience has taught him to see. The dominant paradigm frames how you see reality, in effect. It frames the perception of everyone operating within the dominant paradigm. And you can give here a number of examples from a number of fields. The classic example that Kuhn himself gives is the dominant paradigm of the system of seeing the world and the bodies in space that preceded the Copernican revolution. So in that perspective of the cosmos, the Earth was the center of the cosmos. And this was not to be questioned, because this was the foundational truth of that paradigm and framed the perception of everyone who operated within it, right? Hundreds of generations of people were born and lived and died with this perception on reality, the Earth being the center of the cosmos. And Jordan Hall here has a fascinating perspective on the role of school in the reinforcement of a given paradigm. And schooling is always a way to inculcate and normalize an emerging new generation of people into the existing paradigm, into the existing sets of rules and procedures. So the way he frames it is, school is by and large formally broadcast, right? Broadcast medium, you sit and passively consume. It's a rare student who doesn't learn that their job is not to think. It is to listen attentively to find out what the prefab set of inputs are, and then to carve the correct responses into a nice habit. Just the thing to get an A+ in a 60-minute exam, quickly, reliably, right? So this sounds controversial on the face of it, but this is a pretty much 100% correct observation, because the role of school and schooling as an institution in a modern society, and in fact in any society for that matter, is not to ask students to think, because thinking involves invariably going against established notions of truth. And schooling does the opposite, of course. The role of schooling is to create a mindset which follows the established sets of truths and the parameters for what a correct procedures, what a correct correct actions, what the correct perspectives on reality. Kuhn's perspective on this when it comes to science. No part of the aim of normal science. And by normal science, he talks about science operating within a dominant paradigm, is to call forth new sorts of phenomena. Indeed, those that will not fit the box are often not seen at all. Nor do scientists normally aim to invent new theories, and they are often intolerant of those invented by others. Right? So, Kuhn actually says exactly the same thing as Jordan Hall. The point here in a normal science operating within the normal stage, normal in quotation marks, of a paradigm's life. The role of science in that is that only that which has to be seen and is defined within the parameters of the paradigm can be seen and operated on. Everything else is literally not seen at all. It's ignored, it's invisible. And those who pointed that something else are ostracized, right? Because they are going, in effect, against the herd here. They're going against the majority, against the prevalent perspective. Whatever does not fit the box, no matter how wide that box might be, of the dominant paradigm is A, invisible to that paradigm, and B, is ignored, right, by the people operating within it. But interestingly, it still acts on the world, right? You might ignore that something exists, or you might in fact be completely oblivious to its existence, but that something still acts on the world, and you have to deal with the effects of that something, right? Even though you have ignored it. And this is one of the great dilemmas of the normal stage of operation of a paradigm. Because these things that are ignored, these, let's call them anomalies, they act on the world, right? And the more we allow them to be ignored, the more they multiply. So they multiply over time, requiring more and more procedures to explain them away, to keep them invisible. Because if you allow these anomalies to become visible, you are in effect immediately questioning the fundamental premises of the paradigm. And you cannot do that, right? This is a straight path to ostracism. You become an outcast automatically, right? We'll talk more about this in a second. So the important thing here is that it's inevitably baked in the life cycle of a paradigm, of a way of seeing the world, that certain aspects of reality, and remember, reality is infinitely complex. It is impossible to describe reality in its entirety, in its complexity. And a paradigm is above all a description of reality. It creates a script about reality, script which allows us to act within it. Right? It's a framework of procedures and rules. However, no matter how detailed and how advanced and complex and elegant that script might be, that paradigm might be, invariably it will miss huge chunks of reality. It will not be able to see them, but these chunks of reality will still act on us and on the model itself. And over time, these anomalies, these actions without explanation would only increase or multiply, right? Requiring more and more procedures within the framework to somehow explain them away, right? So you have to keep inventing new theories why something is happening that is not supposed to be happening, right? Something unpredictable is happening. And this invariably leads the normal stage into a crisis. And it brings on the crisis stage. And the crisis stage always starts with the awareness of anomaly, the way Thomas Kuhn frames it. Discovery commences, discovery of something new, right? With the awareness of anomaly, that something is happening that is not supposed to be happening. And that all our efforts at ignoring have failed, right? To ignore that something, that anomaly. And the crisis stage is really fascinating because as these anomalies appear and multiply, these things that were until recently invisible, and B, we tried very hard to ignore when they started being invisible, and C, we started creating more and more complex rules to our existing model in order to deal with these things, that these anomalies, right, that shouldn't be there in the first place. So they appear, they multiply, and automatically by that fact, they start adding complexity to the existing paradigm. It becomes more and more complex, more and more cumbersome, in fact, more and more separated from reality because of that added complexity. Invariably, this leads to a stage in that crisis stage where all the existing procedures that we've deployed, furiously creating new ones, more and more complex ones, fail to explain the anomalies, fail to deal with them, fail to make them disappear, right? To simplify them. And this brings us to a brief definition of the crisis stage, because remember, the normal stage is characterized by habitual, deductive, top-down thinking from established principles, from established rule sets, following the dogma, right? Homogeneously, everyone together. In the crisis stage, we have a dramatic increase in complex protocols because the system, as it were, feels that it's becoming inadequate. And it tries to react to that by creating more and more complex protocols, rule sets, prohibitions, theories about what is happening and how this something fits into the overall system, etc., etc. And you can think of a number of different fields, a number of different examples that fit the crisis stage very well. This you can pick examples from any field, in fact, from economics, from science, from the humanities, from daily life, as it were. Whenever you see a dramatic increase of rule sets and prohibitions and new strange theories, weird approaches to the existing paradigm appearing, a dramatic increase in complexity appearing when it comes to protocols and what you need to do, and etc., etc., this is a sure sign that the dominant paradigm is in a crisis, right? That things are starting to fall apart. And conceptually, this looks like this. You have a paradigm which until now was able to explain most of the visible phenomena, if not all of the visible phenomena, away and fit them into some sort of model. And now they are anomalous multiplying, things that cannot be explained, cannot be fit into a model. And people are starting to see those things, right? They cannot be obscured and ignored any longer. Right? These anomalies start multiplying. And eventually, again, invariably, this is unconditional, in fact, the framework, that entire paradigm that has existed so far, the framework of rules and procedures, is becoming incapable completely of dealing with the rising complexity. It literally cannot handle that multiplication of anomalies and the cost of dealing with them. And usually at this moment comes the time, which is brilliantly picked up by Buckminster Fuller in this quote, where people start despairing about fixing the falling paradigm. Usually this is an impulse of trying to fix things. But people invariably also discover, those who want to fix things, they discover that the system above all resists fixing, right? The system would fight to the death against anyone who tries to fix it in that crisis stage, because everyone who tries to fix it truly instead of cosmetically is appearing to the system in yet another anomaly which has to be resisted. So this is the exact moment where, as Buckminster Fuller says, to change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. This is the exact moment where people discover that you cannot change things in a paradigm in crisis, in a paradigm which is falling apart, which is degenerating, as it were, by fighting that paradigm from within. Because the paradigm will fight you to the death, and usually it's going to be your death, like figuratively or in some cases literally, right? Because the paradigm still has tremendous resources at hand. The only way to change it is to work outside of it on a new model, on a new paradigm. And initially, in that crisis stage, it's only a few people who start questioning the fundamental premises of the paradigm. Remember, this is a situation where a few people discover, initially it's only a few always, that discover that no matter how much they want or try, they cannot fix. They are not literally not allowed to fix, because the issues that have to be fixed are fundamental to the entire paradigm. And if they were to start fixing those issues, they will bring down the entire paradigm. Literally, it will collapse. So they are literally not allowed. They are fought against by the entire model, by the entire framework, and everyone who maintains the model, right? They are literally the enemy personified. So they start questioning the fundamental premises of the paradigm, and the next logical step is they move outside of it. They start operating outside as outcasts. And this brings us to the third stage, and probably the most exciting stage of all stages of all when it comes to the life cycle of a paradigm, the shift. Because this is the beginning. When you see that there are people who have consciously chosen to remove themselves from the paradigm and to start operating outside of it, that you know that you are in the early moments of a shift to a new paradigm. So let's unpack this now. These few people, few individuals initially, start thinking outside the paradigm. They literally abandon the very premises that have built the existing paradigm. So these are people who would be thinking outside of the existing rule sets, the existing procedures, the existing model of reality. These are people who would then start acting outside of the existing procedures and model of reality. They are working outside, they're experimenting outside that old paradigm. Initially, it's only a few of them. And their process is really interesting, because as Jordan Hall points out, this is a little bit like, in fact, it's exactly like real thinking versus simulated thinking, because in a dominant paradigm is already established, all thinking is in effect simulated thinking, right? It's performative, habitual, right? Deductive, you're following established rule sets and not questioning them, right? So you are on autopilot most of the time. But the moment you step outside the paradigm, by definition, you've abandoned these models of thinking and acting and being. So you have to start thinking, and the kind of thinking involved here is real thinking, right? Because you have to start from first principles. And the way he frames it, rather than quickly and reliably returning the right results for the right inputs, like a good habit, thinking begins awkwardly. It's weird from the very beginning. Early on, thinking will struggle to generate anything at all. Simulated thinking can dance and dazzle, while thinking is just learning how to walk. So initially, real thinking, when you step outside of the paradigm, is looks from the outside and might feel to you, the person thinking, as a series of failures, because you are nothing succeeds. It's awkward, it's weird, right? Because you're literally learning from scratch, from first principles, how to deal with reality. You have abandoned the entire framework of rule sets and procedures that has characterized the old paradigm. And those few outcasts, the few outliers who have moved outside of the framework, are now starting to learn how to walk on their own. And this is a fascinating process, and it's something fascinating to observe, and it's fascinating to be in, because this is what real discovery actually is, where you start encountering reality, having disarmed yourself from the rules, as procedures, dogma of the old paradigm, and you discover completely new ways of thinking about reality, and you discover completely new ways of doing in reality, right? You discover completely new models of reality by learning to walk on your own. And usually that is the stage where a number of people, a small number of people, have started experimenting and being in reality, as it were, while really thinking, as opposed to following procedure, that someone proposes a new framework. Invariably, we are made as we have evolved as species to try and model reality, to simplify it into a framework which allows us to act quickly within it, right? So this is a sign of evolutionary adaptation to a complex scenario. So we try and create frameworks, we try and create models. And invariably, someone from those early outliers who have stepped outside and started thinking for themselves proposes a new frame, a new model for thinking and being and operating. And here something very interesting happens, because common wisdom, as it were, received wisdom, would dictate that in a cumulative progression and increase in knowledge, the multitude at this stage would say, oh, this person is brilliant, let's adopt that. But nothing could be further from the truth, because remember, these are outcasts, these are people who have abandoned the old ways of doing things. Right, so from the perspective of the old paradigm, this is an error. Right, the way Jordan Hall frames it, the results of thinking will look entirely unlike the appropriate output that simulated thinking is expecting. As a consequence, for the most part, thinking will show up as some combination of error, disability, or bad attitude. Right, so from the perspective of the old paradigm, this new model is either A, most of the time, completely invisible, right? These people are ignored. Or B, if they cannot be ignored anymore, it's some sort of error, right? Some sort of, at best, error to be corrected, at worst, malignant attack on the truth itself, right? Bad attitude, which has to be fought. So that shift stage is fascinating, because it's characterized by it's an outgrowth, as it were, of the crisis stage initially. So while in the crisis stage the paradigm is furiously fighting to defend itself by multiplying procedures, rules, and dogmas and theories, you have this outgrowth appearing of that stage initially, which is characterized by the appearance of people who think in revolutionary ways, often incomprehensible, foreign or appearing malignant to the legacy paradigm, right? So this is thinking which is revolutionary, inductive, bottom-up, based on individual observations and first principles, as opposed to following dogma, the dogma of the legacy paradigm. And a new paradigm is formed slowly. It is invariably completely different to the old one, right? Invariably, there is a gap, a chasm between them, right? And this is a bifurcation point. In complexity theory, the concept of bifurcation point stands for a scenario where things can go either way. The old paradigm might somehow survive and the new paradigm wither away, or more and more people can start switching to the new paradigm, and the old paradigm in that case would wither away. It's a split, as it were, in the evolution of the old paradigm, because the new paradigm is dramatically different. It's a revolutionary new proposal. And this is a non-negotiable binary state. You are, if you adopt the new paradigm, you have to literally deny everything about the old one. You have to abandon it. So this is a bifurcation. And in that sense, Kuhn is very much correct when he points out that this shift, the moment of the shift, is both constructive and destructive. It's constructive because a new way of seeing the world is formed. A new framework is being developed. A new model is being adopted. While at the same time destructive because all of this panoply of practices, procedures, dogma, theories, perceptions of reality has to be destroyed, right? Have to be abandoned if you're adopting the new one. Right? This is a non-negotiable when it comes to the transition. And usually what happens is that gradually more and more people start shifting to that new perspective on reality, to that new paradigm, to that new framework of seeing the world. And because it is new and fresh and interesting and fascinating and weird and different, it's also empty, right? It just exists as a general proposal and of how things could maybe be, right? And so these newcomers have the ability to start developing concepts and procedures. Often this is what draws them into the new paradigm because this gives them the opportunity and the freedom to create new dogma, new procedures, new rituals, new concepts, new ways of doing things, new ways of being. And like I said, this step from the old to the new paradigm is non-negotiable. You couldn't be in both at once, right? So the decision to reject one paradigm is always simultaneously the decision to accept another. And again, from the perspective of the old paradigm, all of this, what is happening, looks like some sort of hostile enemy action to be fought at all cost. As Jordan Hall frames it, at a social level, thinking will often show up as hostile. Right? Why hostile? Because you are saying things that should not be said, that go against dogma, that go against procedure. Right? What you are saying hurts my feelings. Right? That's why what you're saying is hostile. It hurts my feelings because my feelings are framed to conform to a specific set of rules, right? Coming from a specific paradigm. And what you're saying comes from outside. Hence, it's a hostile act. In a social environment largely conditioned by role-playing identities that allow you to fit in, thinking will be sending everything but the right signals. Right? Because you're not fitting in. You're not role-playing the identity you're supposed to be playing within the dogma. If you're not demonstrating good opinion and responding correctly to the right signals, you won't show up as being part of the in-group. And in fact, the way the in-group and the out-group actually are determined is by sending continuously checking signals to see whether the person will respond in the way they're supposed to. And if they are not responding in the way they're supposed to, they are perceived as hostile. If you aren't part of the in-group, then you must be in the out-group, right? This is how a paradigm maintains itself into existence, literally. So, from the perspective of the old paradigm, everyone who rejects it, who is thinking not habitually, but inductively and differently, thinking for real, as it were, instead of following existing models, literally replicating them, or the way Jordan Hall frames it, role-playing them, role-playing the prescribed identities. So if you reject that, you are viewed as immediately as a heretic and an outcast. Right? You have to be viewed in that way. And we all know what happens to heretics and outcasts. Here we have the example by Piotr Miasoyedov, the burning of Avakum. So we have a heretic which is who is being burnt on the stake in 17th century Russia. For the terrible crime of thinking for himself and operating outside of the dogma. To think, in fact, in an environment infected with simulated thinking, in a habitual environment, right, an environment where you role play the rules and procedures of the dogma, is almost to invite a witch hunt, the way Jordan Hall frames it. And these two paradigms, they're incommensurable. They, and this is something that a lot of people struggle with, they do not have overlapping points. Like, the new paradigm never overlaps with the old one. Why? Because it has to explain everything from the beginning, right? In a new way. So communication across the revolutionary divide between the two paradigms is inevitably partial. At best. Why? Again, because the new paradigm has to establish a completely new framework for being, operating within, thinking in reality. So we described the normal stage, we described its crisis, we described the shift from the old paradigm to a completely new one, which has just emerged. Initially slowly, a few outliers, then a slow trickle of people joining them, excitedly discovering a completely new way of seeing the world and being in the world, or in a specific field. And then more and more people start joining them because they have the opportunity to create the world anew, as it were, to create new procedures, new parameters, new rule sets. And then the fourth stage comes in, normalization of the new paradigm. Over time, usually this takes a lot of time, a critical mass of people adopts the new framework, joins it, as it were. Often, this might involve a generational shift, right? The old generation literally would have to die and the new generation to adopt, to come in with their own new paradigm. Famous physicist Niels Bohr actually framed this quite well when he said that science definitely does not progress cumulatively, slowly over time adding knowledge. The only way science progresses is when the old generation of scientists dies and the new generation comes in and brings in a new paradigm. Literally, that's what Niels Bohr's opinion was. So there is usually some sort of slow trickle of people which expands to a flood, and then a new generation comes in who already may have been normalized in that new paradigm, new way of thinking, and then the old paradigm is shedded away, literally. The new framework that until recently was heretical, that until recently people were victimized for wanting to be part of, is now the dominant paradigm, right? Because the majority agrees with it. The majority is working on its new procedures, reinforcing its rule sets, reinforcing its dogma. Everyone now operates to a completely new set of concepts and procedures, right? Often this is really funny because the people who until the last moment in the shift stage were fighting you for wanting to be part of a new paradigm, for moving away from the old to the new, were victimizing you, attacking you, critiquing you, laughing at you, are now viciously and with equal zeal reinforcing the new concepts and procedures because they have joined the new paradigm, having seen that everyone else has done it, right? Acting as neophytes, they would be zealously reinforcing the new sets of concepts and procedures, having forgotten what they were doing a short while ago. The old paradigm, the one that was dominant until recently, is now condemned, right? Now it is the wrong paradigm. Now it is what those foolish people were thinking of way back when, right? It's outdated, it's primitive, it is against progress. Because progress, this is a really interesting perspective here, but when an old paradigm has shifted into the new one, part of the mythos of the new one that emerges, of the new paradigm, is that we have progressed to a better perspective. right? This is completely irrelevant from the merits of the actual new framework. The point is that this is a necessary myth, as it were, that appears with the shift of the multitudes of the majority of people into that new way of seeing the world, right? So this is a self-reinforcing myth of progress appears, and what was old and discarded naturally is against progress. That is why it was discarded. And when the paradigm changes, the world automatically changes. Why? Because we've changed how we see the world, we've changed how we act in the world, we've changed the rules, procedures, and valorization of our actions in the world, right? Thereby changing the world itself. And interestingly, the heretics and outcasts are now those people, those few remnants who invariably still cling to the old paradigm. Now it is them who are the heretics, right? Until recently, they were in the majority and had the comfort of being the dominant framework. Now they are the heretics and outcasts. The normal has reinforced itself, the new normal, as it was. So we have a cyclical process from the normal, the default, the dogma, to the crisis caused by the explosion in anomalies and the explosion in rule sets and complex procedures for dealing with the anomalies, which invariably fail. So we have a crisis which in itself generates the escape from the legacy paradigm by initially a small group of people, which inevitably rises, leading to a shift to a new paradigm, which for a moment is balanced, as it were, with the old one. There is a more or less equal number of people, and then invariably the new one generates a critical mass of people, and we have a final shift and normalization of the new one. So the new normal appears. And this shift, the final point I want to make is that this shift is invariably a cyclical process, right? This is not a one-off, and this is not a teleological process leading from point A to Z without returning. This is a cyclical process, an iterative cycle, which repeats itself and has always repeated itself. That's it from me on the concept of paradigm shifts. If you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter @TedMitiu. Thank you all for listening, and see you online.